One of the kings of Pinoy metal and considered as one of the most influential band in the OPM alternative scene, Queso. How did they become so popular? What is the future of this band? Most importantly, what is their impact to the OPM alternative scene? We will try to answer these questions in this video. Hello YouTube! Welcome to the Geeky Labs PH. In this channel, we will talk about the OPM alternative scene and pop culture in general. Before we start, kumusta kayo? It's nice seeing you again. How was your holiday? I hope you're having a great time. And while you're at it, please make sure to like and subscribe. It will help my channel a lot. The year was 1994. Tuts Kalinawan got kicked out of high school and he spent an entire year focusing on his music. On the following year, when he got back to school, he met Enzo Ruidera. According to Toots, he was amazed by the looks of Enzo, and right then and there, he decided that he wants to be in a band with this guy. They jammed the next day at school, and they both agreed that they needed a drummer. That's when Enzo introduced a kid he met in kindergarten, and that kid was Paolo Rosal. They jammed a Green Day song, and wala silang idea na it was Paolo's first time ever to sit on a drum set. They were joining Battle of the Bands as a three-piece that covers whatever was popular on the radio at the time. They decided to take their talents to the next level by writing their own songs. They were heavily influenced by acid rock and dance music at the time like Chemical Brothers and Jamiroquai. That's why during the writing process, they decided to add CJ Olaguera to be their percussionist since lagi naman siyang nandon all the time. They originally intended their music to be purely instrumental until Ian Tayo heard them during one of their songwriting sessions at Paolo's place, and Ian eventually asked if he could sing along to their music. Ian Tayo brought his metal influence to the band, which added heavier flavor to their original music. They started playing their original music live, and during one of their gigs in Club Dread, 8 Toleran saw them and was blown away by their energetic performance. Naalala niya bigla na si Ian ay kapitbahay niya lang. During this time, 8 was with a band called Piranha. He got really interested with the music of Cheese because of their energetic performance. He started to hang out with the band and offered to be their sound tech guy until Ian eventually asked him to be the additional guitarist of the band. They later added Artie De Año to be their DJ to add layers to their sound, and in 1997, they released a 2-song demo tape that contains the singles Fine, Look Away! And The Way. This demo helped them to gain followings in the underground scene until the NU107 got a copy of their demo and started playing their music. Due to their growing popularity in the underground scene and constant radio airtime, they eventually got signed by Warner Music Philippines in 1997. And in 1998, they released their debut self-titled album, Cheese. This album contains both of their songs from their demo tape and includes the hits like 10 Times Karma, and Garden Fresh. They blew everyone's mind with their mix of nu metal, funk metal, reggae. They kinda sounded like if Sepultura and Korn had a baby. Their music and explosive live performances made them one of the hottest band on the rise during this era. They were nominated for various awards in the 1999 NU Rock Awards and bagged the Producer of the Year for the works of Mally Andres. The album also went on to win an Awit Award for Best Album Cover Layout for the works of Ron Villaseran. The band's tour for the album around the country was a success, and they even represented the country in the 2000 Busan Rock Festival in South Korea. The band started to write new materials for their second album, and this is where they transitioned from Artie to B-Boy Garcia on DJ duties. They released the album Pilipinas in 2001. Every single that they released from this album was a certified hit, including Parusa, and the song that for me cemented their name into the OPM mainstream, Motaka. Join me as we bowl out in the sunset. This album still features their fusion of nu metal, funk metal, reggae, and jazz, but this time it was heavier. The band won a lot of awards in the 2001 Annual Rock Awards, such as People's Choice Award, Vocalist of the Year, and Album of the Year. And as a thank you to their ever-growing fandom called Mga Daga, they released a live concert DVD called Watatum in 2002. Despite their unstoppable momentum at the time and tons of nominations and awards, the band's relationship with their label started to fall apart.
After namin makita bullshit behind the record companies and yun sa mga gigs, parang hindi naman to yung glam na inisip namin.
This may be due to their very aggressive live performances that almost always ends up in riots, and sometimes they even end up spending nights in jail due to the chaos and energy that they bring to the crowd. According to Ocho, their record label informed them that this will be their last album with them and they will not renew their contract. Warner Music Philippines dropped them in 2003 and they were finally free to do whatever they want and how they want to approach their music. However, there was a problem. Their label was claiming the rights to their name along with the rights to their first two albums. They cannot move forward using the name Cheese without having to pay royalties to the label. This made them switch the name to Queso, which was the Tagalog term for cheese, and it was also the nickname that their fanbase called them. Para sa akin, win-win situation yung pagpalit nila ng name, both para sa fans and para sa band nila. That same year, Pao left the band due to career move and he was replaced by Robert De La Cruz of Skychurch. They spent the year touring the country and started to write their album by 2004. In 2005, they released a documentary DVD, Buhay Queso. In 2006, they released another self-titled album, Queso, and this contains the hits Insecta, and Tiamat. Since they were no longer tied to a record label, they have all the freedom to explore and expand their musicality. That's why to me, this is their most experimental record so far. They highlighted B-Boy's DJing prowess in their tracks Balana and Manila Ice. They also featured an acoustic track, Wara, and the funky avant-garde, Billy Boy. To me, this album solidified that you cannot put Queso in a specific genre. They toured around the country to promote this independently released album. However, in the middle of this, another challenge hit the band. They were dropped by Backbeat Artist Management due to their differences regarding the direction of the band, which affected the band financially due to lack of promotions and bookings, and this added the pressure and the growing tension between the band. Around 2008, Ocho decided to take a break from the band and CJ followed afterwards, until the entire band decided to take a break and focus on their own individual music. To me, this was a good decision to prevent the band from further imploding. The band members stayed active in the music scene. Ocho co-founded the supergroup FRANCO, Ian and Robert started Willa Baliw, B-Boy joined Radioactive Sago Project, Toots continued Cosmic Love together with their first drummer, Pao. It seems like they never left the music scene at all. The band eventually reunited in 2012 with the exception of CJ. Unfortunately, I was not able to find any news about the reason CJ did not come back, so if you know the answer, please put that in the comments. This brings me to the question, how did they make it so big? Their sound was far from radio-friendly, especially at the beginning. Even their most popular song, Motaka, sounds heavy and loud for radio standards, but this song was even played by pop radio stations like Campus Radio, who was one of the most dominant pop radio stations at the time. How did they they do it? To me, there are three reasons. Number one is because of their live performances. Kung nakapunta ka sa isa sa mga gig ng Queso, especially during their early days, you will know what I mean. They are the most electrifying bands during live performances. They can hype the crowd like no other, and that sometimes results in absolute chaos. In one of their interviews, Ocho shared that almost every gig ends up in a riot. There was one time that they even got arrested on stage because of the ruckus and spent the night in jail before going to another show. It was always an energetic and indescribable experience watching them perform. Number two is because of their very charismatic and unique frontman, Ian Tayo. You can't deny that Ian is one of the most influential singers in the OPM alternative scene. His energetic stage antics, his powerful vocals, and his ever-unique singing style, no matter what band he's in, no matter what song, no matter what language, you can definitely tell na si Ian Tayo yung kumakanta kapag narinig mo. He was often imitated, but unfortunately, you simply cannot copy Ian Tayo. Number three, and most importantly, their music. I've already mentioned this multiple times in this video, but just to reiterate, Queso's music cannot be put in a box. In the beginning, they were included in the emerging nu metal scene, but you can clearly tell that they were more than that. While I agree that they sounded nu metal when they were starting, but they sounded nothing like their peers at the time. You can definitely tell them apart between Slapshock and Greyhounds. They still have their distinct signature Queso sound, but you can really tell the difference between their Cheese self-titled album and their self-titled album Queso. With that, what is the future for Queso? They've been around for about 3 decades now and had only released 3 studio albums. To me, Queso still has a lot to offer musically. They are currently working on new materials and have yet to announce when it will be released. Ocho mentioned in one of his interviews that he will be retiring soon and just finishing this album with Queso, but who knows? And that brings us to the last question. What is their contribution to the OPM alternative scene? To me, Queso is the perfect example of the I don't give a fuck attitude. And they prove that you can be big without having to conform on what a rock band should be. In one of their interviews, they mentioned that they were able to see through the BS of the music industry early in their career, and that's when they decided that they will never be controlled by anyone. They showed that music is always their main focus, and that's what everything should always be about. They don't care what other people think or say about them. They wear whatever they want to wear. They do whatever they want on stage during live performance. They're just really focused on bringing a memorable experience with their music. Nowadays, it is very easy to create music in your bedroom with today's technology. However, it is also very easy to be blinded by fame and money. Queso proved that you can be big but stay humble and grounded at the same time. They also showed that a metal band can be successful without having to submit and sell their souls to the label. How about you? What's your favorite Queso song? Alright, that's it for me today and thank you very much for watching. If you like these types of video, please make sure to like and subscribe. It will help my channel a lot. I will see you again next time.